Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming today. This lecture recital concerns itself with a musical instrument few have seen or heard in recent memory, yet it was rather common in France only 100 years ago. I'll speak today about and play the French tuba, which is also known in France as the saxhorn basso, or the tuba in ut. Ut is just the old solfège syllable for C or tonic. It was replaced by do, re, mi, instead of ut, re, mi. Fortunately, I am the proud owner of this fantastic Quainon six-valve French tuba built in 1931, which I bought off French eBay in 2003 for 1,000 euros. These have not been made for 40 years. I was lucky enough to get to use it extensively with my orchestra in the Netherlands. The French tuba was the member of the tuba family written for by all French composers between the year of its invention, 1843, and around 1960, when it finally fell into disuse in French orchestras. During its peak of popularity, orchestral parts were written for it by Ravel, Debussy, Stravinsky, Massenet, Poulenc, Ducas, Saint-Saëns, Franck, Millot, Gounod, Meyerbeer, and many others. Early composers such as Berlioz and Mendelssohn wrote for the serpent or the offerfly, but they later considered the French tuba a worthy substitute. So in the latter half of the 19th century, one would often hear the parts to Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique or Mendelssohn's Midsummer Night's Dream played on this instrument. This was the tuba in France during that approximately 115-year period. This instrument might look like a euphonium to some of you, it is not. While the French tuba and the euphonium are certainly related inasmuch as they both belong to the saxhorn family of conical brass instruments, this particular instrument is in the key of C, while the euphonium is in the key of B flat. Incidentally, it is no accident that these instruments are in the same pitches as the serpent, which were usually in C, and the offerfly, which were usually in the key of B flat. The saxhorns were designed to be successors of the older instruments, and players of both serpent and offerfly often learned to play the saxhorns as a double. Even as late as the 1920s in London, it was not uncommon to find euphonium players who doubled on offerfly. Now, the main difference between the French tuba and the euphonium is 1 foot of conical tubing. If you were to stretch out the main cone or bugle of a euphonium, it would be 9 feet long, whereas the main bugle of this instrument is only 8 feet long. The euphonium is thus 12.3% longer than the French tuba. You might say this is an insignificant difference, but remember, bass trombones and tenor trombones are exactly the same length, yet they produce very different sounds. Only French tubas in C were used in French orchestras, and you would never see a euphonium in a French orchestra. Bass saxhorns in B-flat were relegated to military bands and wind ensembles. You'll also notice this instrument has more vowels than a euphonium. This has 6 vowels. Most euphoniums have 4 nowadays. Remember, this was the tuba in France during the period from 1843 to about 1960, and French composers wanted to write for the entire range all the way down to the pedal tones. The Blakely compensating vowel system, like you find on a modern euphonium, was not invented until 1874. And before that, without all these extra vowels, chromatic scales down to the pedal range were not possible. The 5th vowel also serves as a transposition vowel on this instrument, putting the instrument into B flat. It also comes with a fancy ornate lever to keep this vowel depressed. Now, a little saxhorn history lesson is in order. As I said, the French tuba belongs to the saxhorn family, which was invented by Adolphe Sax in 1843. Sax also invented and patented the saxophone 1 year after his saxhorn patent. The saxhorn family is comprised of valved conical brass wind instruments in a variety of sizes and keys. Sax's idea was to create a homogeneous sound throughout the entire musical range with this group of instruments. So they came in a variety of sizes from sopranino all the way down to contrabass saxhorn, and most were pitched in B-flat or E-flat. He had had this idea while working in his native Belgium, but when crushing debts threatened his livelihood, he accepted an invitation from none other than Hector Berlioz to move from Brussels to Paris to build musical instruments. Within 3 years of Sax's arrival in Paris, he had created and patented the saxhorn family. This, much to the outrage of his competition, who claimed Sachs had done nothing worthy of the patent and had merely imported instruments from Weimar in Germany, where the German version of the tuba had originated. And then he had just made some minor alterations and claimed them as his own invention. His critics had a point insofar as conical valve-based brass wind instruments already existed. Also, sax horns were essentially just ophicleides with valves installed in place of keys. This wasn't really innovation per se, but more a natural evolution once the chromatic valve had been perfected. What sax did do, though, which was unique, was develop these instruments as a homogeneous family, and that in itself was unique, but still not legally patent-worthy under French law. As a result, he was sued by his competitors, and he sued in return, and all involved parties suffered financially as a result. Some competitors went out of business, some moved across borders. Gustav Bessin, for example, moved to London and did very well. Bessin still exists. But Sachs, Bessin the company, not Bessin the guy, but Sachs and his workshop also went bankrupt three times as a result of these lawsuits. Now, in 1845, the French military and King Louis Philippe became rather concerned that the French military music program did not compare favorably to the German military music program. This, of course, was a question of national cultural pride. So plans were made to upgrade and overhaul the military music program. A competition was set up on the Champ du Mars in Paris. This is a large green space right at the foot of the Eiffel Tower. Well, the Eiffel Tower is there now, it wasn't then. Competition was set up there to see who would win the lucrative contract to supply new musical instruments to the entire French military. There were only two groups competing. One band comprised largely of woodwinds led by Michel Carafa, who was an Italian professor of counterpoint at the Paris Conservatory. And the other was a band comprised mainly of Sachs' new sax horns led by Sachs himself. 20,000 Parisian spectators showed up to witness the event, and apparently it was quite the spectacle. The contest was judged primarily based on volume and intonation, and Sachs's gang won handily. As a result, Sachs's workshop became very busy, and the sax horns gained immediate visibility. It is said that as a result, over the next 15 years, Sachs's workshop produced 20,000 instruments. As a sideline, Sachs also led the backstage bands at the Paris Opera from 1847 until 1892. This gave him an opportunity to influence composers and conductors and encourage them to use his sax horns in the opera. This worked quite well, as composers such as Meyerbeer wrote operas with as many as 20 backstage sax horns. It has been calculated that during the period from 1847 to 1877, from the 17 opera productions using banda, backstage band, 59% of those scores required instruments invented by sax. He essentially created a market and a place in music history for his own musical inventions. It has also been widely rumored that Sachs instituted a system of bribes or kickbacks for composers for using his instruments. They would include sax horn parts in their operas, and he would pay them extra for writing them. I have no documentation of this. I'm simply repeating what is said to be common knowledge in the French musical world. Okay, time for some music now. We'll intersperse our demonstration of the different timbres of these tubas on orchestral repertoire with more background on the French tuba as we go along. I've chosen to first demonstrate each excerpt using the instrument most commonly used by most modern tubas today for this particular repertoire. Usually either contrabass tuba in C or bass tuba in F. This will be followed by the same excerpt French tuba. Why is it important to demonstrate the French tuba next to the more modern tubas that have taken its place in the orchestral setting? Well, for 115 years, French composers all wrote with the timbre of the French tuba in mind. Unfortunately, it is current accepted practice that these same works are now performed on instruments which are often twice the length of the French tuba. Here's a visual demonstration. Not only is it twice as long, brass instruments can also be judged by internal volume. Clearly, more than two of this will fit in this, more like four or five. So, yeah. American tubists in particular, I'm American tubist, Commonly choose the largest tuba possible to play any and all repertoire, ignoring clear musical historical indicators that that is the wrong choice. This is musically unjustifiable. These demonstrations are not meant so much to convince or persuade as to which timbre is better, as much as to demonstrate the vastly different timbre French composers had in their ears when writing for the tuba. I feel it is important to realize that this is, in fact, the sound that these great French composers heard and consciously chose instead of the sound of the larger German tubas. We'll now play several excerpts from César Franck's D minor symphony. Although it was written for French tuba, it is most often played on the contrabass tuba in double C today. I think you'll agree there's a huge difference in timbre.
Thank you.
movement. Here's a portion from the end of the first movement. I was remiss in not introducing the backup band. Byron Slew on bass trombone. We used to play in the 27 o'clock flat band together. Eston Bell on second trombone. And Kyle Mullins on first trombone. He's a DMA graduate from North Texas from not so long ago. Anyway, thank you so much for helping me out today. Why did the French write for this smaller instrument? Even though larger, darker sounding tubas were just across the border in Germany enjoying great popularity, for several reasons. French orchestral music is unique and vastly different from German orchestral music. Austro-Germanic music generally deals in masses of sound, using instrument groups together, en masse. It means together. Think of Anton Bruckner, who wrote symphonies using the brass section as if it were a rant on an organ. Or Wagner, who often wrote sweeping tutti's for instrument groups together. The French compositional approach for orchestras was vastly different, emphasizing individual timbres and soloistic virtuosity. The Cambridge Companion to the Orchestra says that the lack of blend was particularly marked in French orchestras, in which individual instruments tended to be quite distinct from each other in tone color. As the kids say, it was a feature, not a bug. French brass playing has often been described as pungent, which to the experienced listener seems an apt description. The American composer Virgil Thompson once wrote of the French orchestral approach to timbres that the French orchestral style is one of equilibration, of clear balances and clean colors, of poetic luminosity rather than of animal warmth. And the whole repertoire of French music composed since Berlioz is designed to profit by this delicate performing style. Leonard Bernstein once described the French orchestral sound as thin, transparent, delicate. Henri Dutilleux used the term sites auricularis, or points of beauty for the ear, to describe the French approach to orchestration. This is a far leaner and soloistic approach to orchestral music than the rest of Europe was pursuing. Another reason that the French tuba flourished in France as opposed to the Germanic tuba. Music in France during this period, and especially in Paris, which was the seat of culture, revolved largely around the theater, and these smaller venues didn't need a massive sound to support the singers, and the pit orchestras were far more modest than German pit orchestras. They just didn't need a big tour. The third reason that this instrument flourished in France during that period was nationalism and tradition. The French have always been a proud people, and they've been rivals to the Germans on a variety of levels for millennia. They would have been loath to adopt a German instrument into the orchestra if not absolutely necessary. This also explains why Sax borrowed the German-invented tuba, made minor changes to it, and turned it into a French invention. Once the French tuba found its niche in the French repertoire and orchestras, the inertia of tradition made it difficult for French orchestral tubas to try other instruments. Our next excerpt will be from Camille Saint-Saëns' Organ Symphony, Symphony No. 3. Also first on the contrabass tuba and then the French tuba. So, where did this instrument go? What happened to it? Part of the reason it ceased to be used is what I call the shrinking world effect. Hi-fi recordings made it possible for musicians to hear great orchestras without having to travel. The shining examples of the Chicago Symphony, Vienna, the Concerto Ballet Orchestra, and so forth were immortalized, and musicians consciously or subconsciously tried to emulate the playing they heard on these recordings. Unfortunately, this was at the expense of their own unique local musical culture. Local stylistic eccentricities and musical flavors began to gradually dissipate and disappear. Also, as conductors became more mobile with the advent of air travel, they would often work week to week with different orchestras, often expecting a similar style of playing in the next orchestra that they just heard in the last one. Again, all this at the cost of local culture. This apparently all came to a head in Paris, 1959. The famed Wagnerian conductor Hans Knobbertsbusch was guest conducting Wagner's Ring at the Paris Opera. This is, of course, a part intended for the large contrabass tuba, actually larger than this. Wagner wrote for the double B-flat tuba. Knobbertsbusch spotted the French tuba in the back row of the pit and insisted that its player Jean-Baptiste Marie play the appropriate contrabass tuba. Marie resisted, but ultimately relented when orchestra management offered him 75% extra above his regular salary for adding this double. It's all about the, whatever the French is for Benjamin, I guess. Other tubists and French orchestras worked out the same deal, and this lasted until each player ultimately retired. This was, of course, costly for managements of French orchestras, and it certainly did not endear the tubists to their employers. Younger and sometimes foreign-born tubists took their places, and it became standard that bass and contrabass tuba was expected for their positions. Now, a different tack. As you can see, there are some practical considerations when deciding to use this instrument. As you can see, the bell goes that way. All the other tubas goes that way. This gives the trombone section a completely different perspective. Not always pleasant. In my own orchestra, we had to hammer out some compromises and agreements about how that was going to work. The trombones hear the tubas much more clearly than ever before. And also, higher frequencies are more directional, so thought must be given to how one projects the sound of the French tuba out into the hall, as the bell points either to the back of the hall or to stage right, where the sound can get absorbed or lost or go up in the rafters. The lower frequency of the larger tuba, in contrast, are more omnidirectional and they seep into the hall regardless. Plus, he's also pointing at the audience anyway. So, one more consideration I discovered when springing this instrument on my colleagues in the orchestra. They had heard me play bass and contrabass tubas next to them on a daily basis for 12 years already. And hearing me produce a vastly different sound with this instrument took them somewhat by surprise. They naturally had preconceived expectations of what I should sound like based on what they had heard for more than a decade. And it took them a while to get on board with it. This is where your good relationships with your coworkers pays off. Now, aside from all the French composers I've mentioned who've written for this instrument, we mustn't forget Igor Stravinsky. Although Russian, he lived in Paris for quite some time while composing for the Ballet Russe, a ballet company which was inspired by and largely directed by Russian talents such as Sergei Diaghilev and Vaslav Nijinsky. Stravinsky's works for this company, which were written for the French tuba, include Petrushka. Now the bear solo makes a little more sense. The Firebird Suite and the Rite of Spring, which was originally written for two French tubas. Now the range of that makes much more sense as well, the high D flat. One interesting side note, the conductor of the UNT Symphony Orchestra before Professor Itkin was a man named Anshel Brusilov, who also served for years as the conductor of the Philadelphia Orchestra. He was my conductor when I was here back in the day. He learned conducting from his teacher, Pierre Monteau, who was the conductor of the world premiere of the Rite of Spring in Paris back in 1913. Music, as all subjects, is full of connections and lineages. You never know when an old person has an interesting story to tell you. So seek them out and ask them questions before they go away. Our next selection is from Ravel's orchestration of Mussorgsky's Picture.